Okay, so far we have been looking at modeling of dynamical systems, and by end of these lectures for about 6 to 7 weeks, we know how to develop models starting from data. So we know how to develop dynamical models starting from physics, linearizing them, coming up with a model which is control relevant. Alternatively, we know how to start from data completely, come up with a model which is control relevant. So now we are at a point where we have a model which can be used for controller synthesis, for controller design, and now we want to embark upon design of the controller. As I said, controller design, given that you have a good model, controller design is relatively easy task. It's not that difficult. So to begin with, I'm going to give one lecture on the concept of stability of discrete dynamical systems, because this is at the heart of design. Okay, this is at the heart of design. These concepts are relatively easy to understand when it comes to linear dynamical systems. So we are going to restrict ourselves mostly to the linear dynamical systems, though I'll touch upon a little bit upon Lyapunov stability, but that's not going to be my non-linear systems is not going to be my focus. We want to restrict ourselves to the stability analysis of discrete time linear dynamical systems. So that is the focus. So at the end of what we have after modeling, whether we have modeled using first principles or whether we have modeled using data, we have this model. Okay, right now you will see that the stochastic component in the model is missing. I have just listed here model with respect to U inputs, known inputs. Okay, right now don't bother about known unknown. I restate the model with respect to inputs. Okay, X are the states, Y are measured outputs. Okay, now X, this model is coming from discretization of a dynamic ODE model which is for a physical system, then X has physical meaning. Okay, if it is constructed as a realization of a time series model, then X may not have any physical meaning, may or may not have meaning. Okay, so you may not be able to associate some physics with X. Nevertheless, this generic form gives us captures the dynamics in the neighborhood of a state. Remember that this is a perturbation model, this is not a global model. This is a model which is control relevant, only valid for a small range. What is that small region? Very difficult to quantify. Okay, very difficult to quantify. When you do perturbation studies, when you inject perturbations, you can say that whatever is the range covered by your perturbations, that is the, when you do linearization through Taylor series, it's difficult to come up with that range. Okay, when you do perturbation studies, it's easier because you have introduced perturbations, you know what is the size of the perturbations, and you can say at least for those perturbations, this model is okay, not bad, good enough. But for linearization business, we do not know. Okay, so we know how to get transfer functions. For this transfer function could be using Q transforms or could be using Z transforms. So both of them, well, the form looks very, very similar. We already know about this, and then this, right now I'm going to look at single input, single output systems. Okay, I would some of the results which I am going to talk about are valid for multiple input, multiple output, but some things are restricted to single input, single output. So we know, we are at this point right now. We know how to come to this point starting from physics or starting from data. That's what we know. Okay. Now there are two things that I should bother about. One is zeros of the transfer function. So I want to worry about the roots of this numerator polynomial, or I want to worry about the roots of the denominator polynomial. In fact, roots of the denominator polynomial is the main thing for design, controller design. Of course, that doesn't mean the roots of the numerator polynomial are not important. They are also equally important. But prime concern many times is the roots of the denominator polynomial. So in control terminology, these roots are called as zeros and poles. And we are going to be more worried in this lecture about the poles. We are not worried about the zeros so much. Okay. Now, stability is a very, very deep concept. It's not of dynamical systems. And again, as I've been saying that, you know, the stochastic processes which I introduced in the last few lectures has matured over two centuries. Same is true about stability analysis. Stability analysis of dynamical systems has been studied since Newton. And what we study now in classroom probably took hundreds of years to develop. So it's not a easy concept to digest. Well, I'm going to introduce two kinds of stability concepts. One is unforced stability, and other is the forced stability. Okay, what is unforced stability? Okay, let me just go back and view some concepts again. Is this a forced system or an unforced system? It's a forced system. The forcing function is U. Okay, forcing function is U. So this is a forced system. Under certain situations, this forced system, particularly when you are designing a controller, the forced system can get transformed into an unforced system. Okay, the forced system can get transformed into an unforced system. So unforced system, what will be equivalent of unforced system here? If uk is 0 for all the time, if uk is 0, then you will get xk plus 1 is equal to phi of xk. Okay, this is unforced system. There is no forcing function in that case. Okay. And so we want to look at two stability concepts. One is forced stability, another is unforced stability. Unforced stability talks about a system in which there is no forcing function. Okay. Or by some manipulation, forcing function has disappeared. Maybe you have put a controller and you know your forcing function no longer exists, so it becomes an unforced system. Or the other thing that we are worried about is what is called as input-output stability. Okay, this is forced stability. So these two are different concepts. They are related but not equivalent. Okay, there are subtle differences, and as a control engineer, we have to be aware of these. Okay, so why do I need to look at unforced stability? You might ask this question. Why do you look at unforced stability? We always have, you can control a system if there is a forcing function. If there is no forcing function, there is no way of controlling a system, right? If you cannot inject any input to the system, okay, you cannot manipulate, right? It exists on its own, okay? Like solar system is a dynamical system, okay? At least we as human beings cannot, at least till now, inject any input from outside to perturb it, right? So it works on its own. There is nothing that you can do about it. You can just observe, you can write a model, but not that you can manipulate something, okay? Okay, so in a typical feedback control system, we want to put a feedback control law. Let's look at a very simple feedback control law, okay? I'm trying to come up with a very simple feedback control law. UK, okay, are the inputs. They are proportional to, let's take simple proportional controller. What is proportional? All of you know what is proportional controller from the first course in control. Set point minus measurement, okay, times some constant for a scalar case. For a vector case, if I generalize, be times some matrix. So what I've done here is I've written this control law, UK is equal to G. G is a matrix. Matrix times RK minus YK. Okay, RK is my set point. Okay, YK is my measurement coming from the plant. And my control law is, well, actually, let me put this internal form here. Actually, YK is equal to C of XK, is some function of XK. So I'm putting that here. And I'm transforming this system now. I'm just going to rewrite this system. I'm going to write u, I'm going to substitute this formula for u into my original equation. Okay? My dynamic equation. If I substitute this formula for u in my dynamic equation, I get this equation. I'm going to call this as a closed loop equation because now u has disappeared. U is function of r minus y. But y is function of x. Okay? So if I substitute, I get this. Now let me look at a scenario where r is 0. Okay? Set point is 0, perfectly fine. I want to control the system at the origin, at the steady state where we have linearized. Okay? My set point is 0. My x will be 0. If x is 0, cx is 0. Okay? I want to control my system at the origin. This is the typical problem, regulation problem in any system, say process system. You have a reactor or you have some level in the tank. You want to control it at 0. 0 means 0 perturbation. You have defined some operating point. Okay? You want to maintain the 0 perturbation. The level should be at the desired point. Okay? So that's what I mean here. What has happened here is moment I introduce this control law and I set r is equal to 0, set point is equal to 0, I get an unforced system. I think you might remember this little painfully if you have not been able to do the last problem in the mid-sem. It's the same problem, right? Little bit of manipulation just gives the same problem. Okay. And we have already talked about stability of these kind of systems. When are these systems stable? Eigenvalue of phi minus gamma gc, phi minus gamma gc are inside the unit circle, then they are asymptotically stable. Okay. So this is an unforced system and we know about the stability. I just want to okay. So there is one more example. Why do we want to look at unforced stability? Let's say I have an open loop system. See, one is closed loop system. So in the closed loop systems, I get a situation where I have, you know, a dynamic system which is unforced. Okay, and I'm worried about stability of this unforced system. Well, not only stability of the unforced system, I'm also worried about the performance of the unforced system, right? See, if you just go back here, this matrix, eigenvalues of this matrix govern the dynamics, okay? And here, what is it that I have introduced as a control engineer? Matrix G. Matrix G is my choice. Okay, so I can move around eigenvalues of this matrix by appropriately choosing G. Actually, that's a controller design problem. I choose G in such a way that poles of this matrix are at desired location. Right? That is my controller design problem. The other situation is that I have a system. Let's look at a single input system. And let's say the input is a sinusoidal function, is always a sinusoidal function. Input to this particular system is always a sinusoidal function. Let's say a circuit which is subjected to some, AC current, permanently subjected to the AC current. I cannot manipulate, the input is always this AC current and I want to worry about the dynamics of this particular system. Okay. In this case, my dynamical system becomes like this, right? This part here is fixed. Okay. Again, this is an unforced system because this component is not in my control. This input is entering the system. Okay. And I have to worry about. So I might generally say that I am really worried about unforced dynamical systems. Okay. In which the right hand side would be function of xk. And in general of time k. K is the time here. So it could be in general function of time k. The previous example, k was not explicitly appearing. In this particular example, k is explicitly appearing in my equation. Okay. So this is a time-varying unforced system. So general problem which we would be worried about is, okay, well, I'm not going to look at least for this course, I'm not going to look at the time-varying unforced systems. That's more complex. Okay, I'm going to study simple things, introduce concepts regarding unforced system, okay, in which time doesn't explicitly appear. Okay, the other things, of course, we need to study in real problems, but we are doing a first course on advanced control, so we can excuse ourselves and just restrict to the simple ideas. Okay, so this is a general problem. I have this dynamical system, xk plus 1. It evolves according to this nonlinear difference equation, okay, where f is some nonlinear function, where f is some nonlinear function, and x0 is the initial condition, x0 is the initial condition, which is away from the equilibrium point. Equilibrium point for this system, let's assume it's 0, 0. Perturbation system. X is a perturbation model. Some it could be linear or nonlinear. Okay. Oh, well, I'm going to introduce this non-zero equilibrium point. What is the steady state of this point system? When do you say the system enters steady state? Xk plus 1 is same as xk. I have written it in by saying that x bar is equal to f of x bar. Okay, so x bar is my steady state operating condition. Okay, and x bar is equal to f of x bar is my, okay, so now this is where you are going to blink and then not going to be comfortable. Okay, let's see what this is. When do you say a particular system to be, let's, before we look at the theorem statement or the definition of stability, let's take a famous example which is often used to teach the stability. I'll also take a chemical engineering example later, but a simplest example is a pendulum. Okay. Now a pendulum can be, you know, working like this. Okay, there is one more configuration for the pendulum, which is inverted pendulum. Okay, I could have a pendulum which is like this. Okay, so this example of inverted pendulum can be looked upon as a idealization of a scenario where, you know, you have a rocket, space launch rocket taking off, and before it is taken off, you know, it's just balanced on a platform, right? It's balanced on the platform. It should not fall while taking off. It should remain vertical and then go into. So it is actually, if you have seen those clips, you will see that before the takeoff, it is clamped using some supports. Okay, you don't allow it to move. But you can't do that when the rocket launches. So you have to remove the support. Okay, and then balancing that rocket on the platform below is same thing as balancing a stick on your hand. It's not different. There is an equilibrium point where the rocket exactly stands vertical. Okay, provided the vector from the center of mass goes through the base and all that. So if that doesn't happen, the rocket might fall and then it might hit, you know, some other country rather than going into space. So that is a difficult problem. Okay, but so this is a valid configuration. We need this configuration and we want to control that configuration. So this configuration is the other configuration where, you know, pendulum is moving like this. What will happen is if I perturb the pendulum will come back after some time. Okay, if you have a perfect pendulum, no dissipation of energy. Okay, what will happen? It will keep oscillating. Okay, if you have a real pendulum where energy dissipates, what will happen? And the, you know, you move the pendulum and leave it, after some time you know, it will, the oscillations will die down and it will come to the steady state. What is the steady state? You know, it is vertically down, that is a steady state. It comes back to that steady state. So, if I look at x bar is equal to f of x for the pendulum system, there are two possible solutions. There are two possible solutions. Actually, physically two possible solutions. Theoretically, there are infinite solutions because, you know, this is a steady state, and so if you rotate once, this is also a steady state, and then you rotate twice, it's also a steady state. So mathematically, there are many steady states. Physically, there are two steady states. One is up, one is down. Okay. Now, how do I mathematically quantify this idea that if I perturb a little bit, the system comes back? The system is comes back to its original steady state. Okay. I want to mathematically express this idea. What will happen here? In this case, there is no control. Suppose, you know, you are, see, if you are, if I, this pen is there on my hand, and if I am allowed to move my hand, I am using a degree of freedom, I am using manipulation to control the system. Okay. But if I am not allowed, there is one perfect steady state for which if the system is at that steady state, it will remain at that steady state. But what will happen if there is a slight perturbation? It will fall. Okay, I want to quantify this mathematically. Mathematically, the example from chemical engineering, there are examples from other domains. Okay, example from chemical engineering also is reactors, where you have multiple steady states. Typically, what happens is that a reactor would have multiple operating conditions. Okay, so there are two operating conditions which are stable. One is low temperature, where you don't get a product. One is high temperature, where you get good amount of product, but the temperature is very high. You don't want to control at that point. And there's a middle temperature where you get reasonable amount of product, but the middle temperature is, you know, not steady. It's a unsteady state point. So actually for a reactor, if you take this heat generated and heat released, okay, heat removed, then heat generated is actually a S-shaped curve, okay, this is Q generated, and heat removed, okay, there is a cooling jacket, and you remove the heat through the cooling jacket, and heat removal is proportional to cooling water temperature minus the temperature inside the reactor. So heat removed is proportional to the, if you plot T versus QG, then you get three steady state. One is at a lower concentration, other is at the higher concentration, and this one is an unstable steady state. Stable steady state, and this is stable steady state, and this is stable steady state. Okay, and you want to control the system at this point. Okay, controlling the system, controlling the reactor at this point is same thing as controlling the, you know, stick, balancing the stick, inverted pendulum. No difference. Okay, a slight movement will take the system either to this point or to this point. Okay, where will the system go? If it is uncontrolled, you do not know. So, to make the system stay at this point, you have to apply a controller. But this point is an unstable point. Okay. Now, how do we understand this concept of how do we quantify this? Okay. So, we are going to use a basic definition of continuity of a function. If you see carefully, this is a modified definition of continuity. Okay. So, what I am saying here is that if I perturb the system, if I come up with a region, suppose I am looking at a pendulum, okay, I am looking at a pendulum. I look at some region, okay, in the neighborhood of the steady state. Okay, let's say I give you that this region is where the movement, motion of the pendulum should be restricted to. Okay. Now, if I give you this region, okay, you have to tell me set of initial conditions. You have to tell me set of initial conditions for which the system dynamics will remain bounded in this region. Okay. So think of it as some game, you know. I define a region, okay. I define this much region, and then I'll say that tell me all initial conditions for which, if I take my pendulum, the system dynamics will remain within this bound. Okay, so suppose you come up with a set of initial conditions. I'll say, okay, I'm not happy. I'll shrink. Okay, can you give me another set of initial conditions for which the dynamics will remain inside this? Okay. You will come up with one more set of initial conditions for the pendulum, so the dynamics remains inside this. I will go on shrinking this. Okay. So, whatever region I give, if you are able to come up with a set of initial conditions for which the dynamics will remain within this, or within this, or within this, or within this, okay, then we say that the system is locally stable. Okay. Whatever region you come up with, whatever region I come up with, you have to give me set of initial conditions. If that is possible for a particular system, see, for what I am saying is for every r greater than 0, okay, xk minus x bar is my steady state. Xk minus x bar is the evolution of dynamic evolution of the system. Okay, if this remains less than this big R is what I am giving you, okay, and for this system to be remain bounded in this region, if you are able to find a set of initial conditions, okay, this is x naught minus x bar is the initial condition. For this initial condition, okay, the system will, so let's go back to this picture. Okay, let's see whether we can understand it from, see, okay, see, suppose this is the point, this is x1, x2, and initially, you know, I will give you that this is the region in which all the motion of the system, x1 and x2, should remain bounded. So, I want it to be remain bounded here, okay. I want it to be remain contained in this region. Okay. So, I have given some R. Okay. Can you find out a set of initial conditions? Let us say this is the set of initial conditions for which if the motion starts from here, from any point in here, okay, if the motion starts from any point in here, it will remain bounded in this region. Okay, it remain bounded in this region. If I happen to change this, you know, if I say that my R is this much, still you should be able to come up with some set of initial conditions. You know, if I shrink this, if I say that my R is not big, my R is very small, you should be able to come up with set of initial conditions for which if motion starts within this point, it will remain bounded in this region. Okay, if motion starts within this point, this region, it will remain bounded in this larger region. Okay, that's what I am asking. Is this possible for every R? Whatever R I am saying, it should happen. Okay, now why this every R is so important? Okay, if it happens for just one R, is it good? It's not good. See, for example, if I define my R which spans this region, entire region, okay. See, for this system, what will happen? For this system, if the reactor is here, it will either go here or it will either go here. Okay. So, if I give my R which spans both of this, then you will say, well, system remains bounded and it is stable. Right? System remains bounded because if my region is very large, okay, then there are set of initial conditions for which system will remain bounded in this. Okay. But if I start shrinking this, there is a problem. then you cannot find a set of initial conditions for which system will stay inside that boundary. Okay. So this is what is actually quantified by this definition, that given any R, given any region, can I find a set of initial conditions for which the system dynamics will remain bounded in that region? If that can be done, then we call the system to be stable, unforced stable, okay, also sometimes called as Lyapunov stable. Okay, this is picturization. So given any bounded region, can I find a set of initial conditions for which the motion will remain bounded within the given region? Okay. In fact, when you start looking at stability, you get tempted to think other way around. Okay. You start saying that given an initial condition, can I found a region? That is not a correct way of thinking. In fact, that was a mistake which was made historically when people started looking at stability. They first said, well, given an initial condition, can I found a region in which it will remain? Okay, that is not, there might be one region in which it might remain, you know. What is important is, the question is, if I perturb a little bit, will it go outside? See, if I define a region which covers even this steady state, if I define a region which also covers this steady state, then you will say that system is stable. But actually, you know the system is not stable. So this definition will not work the other way around. Okay. Only way it will work is saying that for every small region, so you know, I am not interested in a region which covers this steady state and this steady state. I am here right now. I give a small region around this. Now, can you find out a steady state? Can you find out an initial condition for which system will stay here? Except at the steady state, that you cannot even move a little bit. Even if you move a little bit, this will fall. This will leave the region. Okay, so that is very, very important. You have to think about this, look at more examples. This is not a thing which will go down so easily. Well, we have another concept which is asymptotically stable. Asymptotic stability comes if the dynamic remains bounded within a region, but the trajectory goes to zero trajectory goes to the steady state as k goes to infinity. See, if it happens that this trajectory is starting from x naught, and not that it just remains bounded, but it also converges finally to the steady state. That will happen for a pendulum, right? It will, you perturb it, okay? It will oscillate and come back to the steady state. Wherever you perturb it, okay, it will oscillate and come back to the steady state. So a pendulum, which is not inverted, the regular pendulum, is an asymptotically stable system. It will come back to the, but a pendulum, a regular pendulum, which has no damping, is not asymptotically stable, which has no damping. What is the meaning of no damping? It will keep oscillating. Oscillations will not grow. Oscillations will not die down. Okay? They will not grow. They will neither grow nor die down. So those systems are marginally stable systems. Neither oscillations grow nor they die down. If the oscillations eventually die down as k goes to infinity, okay, then those are called as asymptotically stable systems. Okay? Or the equilibrium point is called as, let me revise. We cannot say a system is asymptotically stable or system. We misuse this terminology for linear systems, because linear systems stability concepts are global. You know, everything, either it is globally asymptotically stable or globally marginally stable or globally unstable. Okay. In real nonlinear systems, you have to talk about local stability in neighborhood of a point x bar. Okay. In neighborhood of a point x bar. That's what makes sense in a real nonlinear system. Okay. So one thing that because we are introduced to stability in the control course, where you start looking at linear dynamical systems, one thing that we start thinking about is that unstable system means something going to infinity. Okay, the trajectory should go to infinity. That is not what it means. It only means that the locally that point is, see, the pendulum dynamics, it doesn't go to infinity because you have an unstable point. Okay. So that is only ideal world of linear systems. It happens that trajectory goes to infinity. In reality, all that it means is that it's a point where local any trajectory doesn't tend to stay. It's a point where system has a tendency to go away from that point. That's all it means. So stability is a local concept in the context of nonlinear systems, in the case of real world systems. And we can talk about an equilibrium point to be stable or an equilibrium point to be unstable. Okay, that makes more sense. Well, asymptotic stability of equilibrium, well, we know something already. We have done this. When is linear dynamic system stable? Spectral radius is less than 1, strictly less than 1. It is asymptotically stable. If it is less than or equal to 1, it is marginally stable, and it could be, one of the eigenvalues is equal to 1, then or pair of eigenvalues is on the imaginary axis, it is marginally stable. It will, okay. We know this result that spectral radius, if it is less than 1, so we can apply it in a different context. And both the contexts now you are aware of, that you could apply it to open loop systems. If u is 0, you could apply it to the closed loop systems. If u is function of y, in turn function of x, I could apply it to. So of course, my controller design problem is to choose g in such a way that, controller design problem is to choose g in such a way that spectral radius is always less than 1. Okay. In fact, I might decide and say I want it to be 0.1. Okay. So that the rate of change of error will also, or the rate of change, the rate of at which the system returns to the steady state also will get defined if you specify the poles. Now there is a problem. This result, which is very, very powerful for the linear systems, cannot be taken to nonlinear systems as it is. Okay, there's a difficulty. You can use this result for nonlinear systems through local linearization. We have done local linearization. We started from teleseries, nonlinear model, locally linearized. Now the question is, well, the golden question, analysis of the local linear model, does it also hold for the global nonlinear model? It's a relevant question, because ultimately you are going to base your design decisions on the local linear model. But the true system is not local linear, true system is nonlinear. Okay. Now, trouble is, you can carry over these results of linear. Now, these results which I have listed here, okay, these are for ideal linear system, ideal linear world which we have created as, applied mathematicians. Not, it doesn't exist anywhere. It exists only in our imagination and textbooks. Okay. There is no perfect linear system anywhere in the world. It's always an approximation which. Now, we also know this, that open loop system is marginally stable if rho is equal to 1, and it is unstable if rho is greater than 1. Okay. Now, the trouble is this. Results or analysis based on local linearization can be used only for two cases. If locally matrix or locally system is asymptotically stable, or if locally system is unstable. Okay. If locally system is asymptotically stable, then behavior of the local linearization and nonlinear system is, you can make some comment. Based on the local linearization, you can make a comment upon nonlinear system behavior. If locally system, linearized system is unstable, then the nonlinear system is also locally unstable. Okay. But if local linearization is marginally stable, I cannot say anything about the nonlinear system. This is the trouble. I cannot translate results. Okay. So, marginal stability, you cannot establish using local linearization. You can establish asymptotic stability. You can establish instability, but not marginal stability. Okay. Not marginal stability. And there are marginally stable systems which we keep using all the time. It's not that marginally stable systems don't exist. You must have seen old pendulum clocks. Pendulum there is a marginally stable system. It neither decays, okay, and nor it grows, right? So oscillators, we use oscillators, you know, at so stability of such marginally stable systems, which are actually nonlinear, cannot be established through linearization. Asymptotic stability, yes, you can. Okay, instability, you can. That's why you are still able to use linear control theory and design a controller for a real world nonlinear problem. Okay, but it has a limitation because marginal stability of linearized model cannot say anything about the stability characteristics of the nonlinear system. I'll give you an example so that it will become clear. I'll give an example where linearization says that the system is marginally stable, but actually the system is asymptotically stable. Okay, so if linearized system says marginal stability, you cannot draw any conclusions. Linearized system says asymptotic stability, yes, the nonlinear system is also locally asymptotically stable. Okay, linearized system says unstable, nonlinear system is locally unstable. Okay, so I'll just give you some visualization of a two-dimensional system. This face pane portraits is something which is very, very often used to visualize dynamical behavior of two state systems. Okay. So I'm right now talking about continuous time systems. Right now I'm talking about continuous time systems. So if you have a system, a nonlinear system or a linear system, for the time being, let's take a linear continuous time system, two differential equations. Okay, so I'm actually worried about, for the time being, what I'm going to show you is dynamic behavior of this is my A matrix. Okay. For the time being, don't worry where this system has come from. You have this system and you are analyzing this system. Okay. What you know is that the dynamic behavior of this system is governed by eigenvalues of A matrix. Right? It's governed by eigenvalues of A matrix. So A will have two eigenvalues, lambda 1 and lambda 2. Right? A will have two eigenvalues, lambda 1 and lambda 2. Of course, if you want, you can discretize this and convert into a discrete form, but there is a mapping between continuous and discrete, and the results of dynamics will not change. Okay. So this is just a visualization of what is happening. This is important in the viewpoint of, I'm just putting these figures to enforce the concept that these are local behaviors. Okay, so one thing that we look at is a system which has two eigenvalues which are, you know, negative real part. I'm talking of continuous time system right now. Okay, for a continuous time system where both the eigenvalues have negative real part, what happens? Mathematically, we say that the solution decays to 0, 0. Asymptotically stable. Pendulum, okay, the motion comes back to the steady state. Okay, perturbation state is steady state. So, you know, any trajectory that starts in the state space, these are different trajectories in x1, x2 plane. I'm just plotting the time trajectories in x1, x2 plane. You start from some point, this trajectory will eventually come back to the origin. You start from some other point, it will come back to the origin. So locally, because the eigenvalues have negative real part, all the trajectories will come back to the origin. So this is called as stable node. Other possibility is unstable node. What is unstable node? All the trajectories diverge from this point. Okay? All the trajectories diverge from this point. Nothing stays here. Okay? That's what I wanted to visualize when. So if you are perfectly here, see, pendulum, if I am perfectly here at 0, 0, it will remain at 0, 0. But any small perturbation will take the system away. Okay? In reality, for the pendulum, it is not going to go to infinity. So don't associate instability means something going to infinity. That is not the thing. Okay? It only means that this point is such that nothing stays at this point. You know, the system tries to run away from this particular point. No, this is for, there are slight differences for second order system. You have something called saddle point. So if one is, so it is unstable, but saddle point, there might be certain directions in which system will not become unstable. So if you have this situation that one eigenvalue is less than 0 and one eigenvalue is greater than 0, okay, then the system is, you know, somewhere in between, actually. It is unstable system technically because, okay, but there are some trajectories, okay. If you happen to latch onto those trajectories, you will not leave those trajectories. So you will not go to infinity, okay. So that, see, here what happens is that there is only one point where, you know, if you are there, you will stay there. Otherwise, any perturbation from there, you will go away. Okay. Now for a saddle point, what happens? If you happen to stay, I think on this V1, sorry, V2. If you happen to stay on V2, then you will remain on V2. Okay. If you happen to stay on V2, you will remain on V2. But anywhere else, it will tend to go away. It's a little funny situation. Okay. So this is only mathematical possibility. It's not that. A real system which has one eigenvalue which is outside unit circle or one eigenvalue which is on the right half plane, system is unstable for all practical purposes. But this is a finer point which this is classified as a saddle point. Okay. Well, the other thing is, you know, center. Center is where both the eigenvalues are complex. Okay. What is the equivalent thing in terms of discrete time? Here, one eigenvalue is inside unit circle, one eigenvalue is outside unit circle. Here, both the eigenvalues are on the unit circle. Okay? Both the eigenvalues are on the unit circle. Okay? Then you again differentiate between unstable systems. So you have a stable focus. A stable focus is where you have complex eigenvalues. You have complex eigenvalues, but the real part is negative. Okay? Pendulum, you know, it will have oscillatory behavior, but oscillations die. Oscillations don't grow. Okay. So, unstable focus is one from which locally, you know, the system diverges, but in an oscillatory manner. Okay. Diverges in an oscillatory manner. So, that will be an unstable focus. So, these are local behavior. That's what I want to emphasize through these graphs. Nothing else. Okay, we are looking at locally at some point in the neighborhood of that point we are trying to assess. Everything of these cases we can analyze through local linearization of nonlinear system except this case. If you take a nonlinear set of system, two nonlinear differential equations, come up with linearization, and then linearization tells you that actually it's a center, you can't believe that result. You cannot extrapolate that to the nonlinear system. Okay? So whatever you come up with analysis with linearization only holds for all cases except center. Okay? Okay, there's one more concept which is very, very crucial in control theory. So till now I talked about unforced stability. Okay? Talked about unforced stability. So unforced stability can arise because you have lost degree of freedom. How did you lose degree of freedom? Because you have put a controller. Okay. The second thing is, you know, input and output stability. When I want to talk about stability concept, when I have some degrees of freedom, okay, and I still want to know about behavior of the output with respect to inputs. Okay. Mind you, there was one difference. Earlier, we were worried about the evolution of states. Earlier, I was talking about evolution of states. Okay? I was only talking about X. Whether X has a physical meaning or doesn't have a physical meaning is a different story. I was talking about behavior of X. Okay? In input-output stability, I'm going to be worried about Y and U. U is my input, Y is my output. I'm only worried about observed states or observed behavior. Okay? I'm not, let's say I have a boiler. Okay? There are so many states inside the boiler. Okay, if you write a differential equation and then come up with a model, you'll get many, many states for temperature and level and whatnot. If I'm just measuring level and temperature, okay, and if I'm giving two inputs, one is fuel, other is cold water flow, I'm only worried about behavior of, you know, level and temperature with respect to cold water flow and fuel flow. Input, output. I'm not worried about what is happening inside. I'm not saying that I'm not worried about, I'm not talking about it when I talk about Bebo stability. Well, you might say that why I'm introducing all these mathematically fine notions. We can't help it. Control theory, you are dealing with dynamical systems and you have to understand these finer points. Otherwise, okay. So Bebo stability is a linear invariant system is Bebo stable if a bounded input produces a bounded output. Okay? If I give a bounded input, now what is bounded? Good question. Okay. Because when you say when you call a function bounded, we are dealing with functions. Input will be a function, say cos function. Okay. Or you know, input is ut is a step function. So is step function a bounded function? It depends on what? Ah, no. Tell me, improve upon it. Smita, something else we talked about in the last course. What about norm? I could talk about a norm of a function. Okay, if norm is bounded, then the function is bounded. Okay, so bounded input, bounded output stability actually gets tied up with the norm of a function. So question comes, what is a bounded function? Okay, now is actually magnitude is not a bad idea, but is but you have to put it in the right context. Now, is step function a bounded function? How do you define boundedness? Suppose I give you norm of a function. So now I'm talking about a function ft, okay, which is equal to a cos t, a cos omega t. Okay. Now t belongs to 0 infinity. Okay. What is norm of this function? How do you define a norm? How do you say this function is bounded or unbounded? integral? Well, you could define different ways. You could define one norm, you could define two norm, you could define infinite norm. Okay, this function might turn out to be bounded according to one norm but not according to some other norm, that is possible. Okay, see, for example, this function, I can define a norm of ft as integral 0 to infinity mod ft. So norm of ft, you know, I am calling one norm is equal to 0 to infinity dt. What is two norm? Right? What is infinite norm? Max over t mod of ft. Okay? So these are three different norms. Okay. Now tell me whether step function is it bounded according to one norm? Unit step function. No. It's not bounded according to one norm. Is it bounded according to infinite norm? Yes. Okay. So this bounded input, bounded output stability actually also depends upon the way you define the norms. Typically you would use infinite norm. Let's say if you decide to use infinite norm, then according to infinite norm, step function is a bounded function. Cos omega t is a bounded function. Okay. You can have a very, very simple definition. You give a region, if the input function remains bounded in that region, then it is bounded according to infinite norm, not according to one norm or two norm. Okay. We can, but when I have to choose mathematically, you have to give a reason for that. So yeah. No, but what I wanted to point out was that it crucially depends upon how you define what is bounded. Okay, so it is not that. Exponential function is bounded according to one norm, e to the power minus t, as t goes to infinity, or e to the power minus any a t is bounded function according to one norm, according to two norm, according to infinite norm. But that doesn't mean it is step function is bounded according to all these norms. Okay, so it's convenient to use infinite norm when you are doing this Bebo stability. Okay. Now, this part is very, very important here. Okay. So this last thing which I have underlined is very, very important. This should happen for every initial condition. Okay. So one way to find some system is unstable is to find one initial condition for which this will not hold. Then. Now there are finer things here, you know. If you have a system which is, we are talking about a state space model, and obviously if the spectral radius is less than 1, then, you know, then the system relating, or the transfer function relating y and u is Bebo stable. Why is that? Because what is the relationship between the denominator of the transfer function and poles of phi? Eigenvalues of phi? They are same. Eigenvalues of phi is nothing but the characteristic equation. Okay? So if all the eigenvalues are inside the unit circle, then but what I want to say here is that a system which is asymptotically stable in the sense of Lyapunov, okay, unforced system is asymptotically stable. Okay, if you take this, let me go back to this. So when I am talking about unforced stability, I was talking about only xk plus 1 is equal to phi xk. Okay, when I'm talking about Bebo stability, actually I'm worried about this stability of this transfer function. Okay, are there systems for which the transfer function is stable but the state dynamics is unstable? Possible. That is possible. Okay. Unstable or marginally stable? Marginally stable, not unstable, marginally stable. It's possible that there are pole zero cancellations and you know you have a system which is the state space dynamics is marginally stable, but this is Bebo stable. So all those kinds of things are possible. Now the question is, if spectral radius of phi is less than 1, that means all the roots of this equation are inside unit circle. Okay, they're inside unit circle, and then we can talk about, you know, we can say that if this system is asymptotically stable in the sense of Lyapunov, unforced system is asymptotically stable, then this transfer function is Bebo stable. Okay, if this phi has all the eigenvalues inside the unit circle, then this system is bounded input, bounded output stable. Vice versa is not true. Suppose I don't say anything about this, I just give you the transfer function. From the transfer function that you found that the transfer function is bounded input, bounded output stable. Can you say that, you know, all the eigenvalues of phi will be inside unit circle? That is a tricky thing. You cannot go other way around. You can say that if this is asymptotically stable, this is Bebo stable. But if this is Bebo stable, you know, the original system can be marginally stable or something else. So there is a problem. So that one way thing works, the other way it doesn't work. Observable. Don't confuse them with this. Observability, we'll talk later. Right now, there is no question of observability yet. We're not talking about that. Bebo can be? Bebo can be, no. So what I want to say is that asymptotic stability is a stronger concept than Bebo stability. So asymptotic stability implies Bebo stability, but Bebo stability doesn't imply asymptotic stability. Okay, so this is an example of a harmonic oscillator. Okay, this unforced system is stable. Okay, which means its spectral radius is equal to 1. Okay, it is stable in the sense of Lyapunov. Unforced system is stable. If you take this system, okay, don't worry about the u, put u equal to 0, you take this system. Okay, for this system, eigenvalues are on the unit circle, this system is stable in the sense of Lyapunov. Okay, it is stable in the sense of Lyapunov. Now, this particular system has poles on the unit circle, and actually that makes it Bebo unstable. So actually, if you introduce bounded input into this particular system, okay, then the output actually grows with time. Okay, so the conclusions that you reach by putting u equal to 0, okay, about the stability are different from the conclusions that you reach by putting a forcing function u. Okay, for this particular system, if you introduce a cyclic u, okay, then the output will grow. Okay, but if you say u is equal to 0, then spectral radius is equal to 1, and then you will say this is Lyapunov stable. So there are some subtle differences between these two things. You'll have to go back and think about it. I cannot explain everything. We look at more examples. We look at some cases. It is marginally stable system. Okay, so but marginal stable, so asymptotic stability of phi will imply Bebow stability. Okay. So here I am showing a situation where original system is marginally stable. Okay. But it is Bebow unstable. Okay. So these two are different. All that I want to point out here is that these two are different notions. Okay. And only when you have state space model to be asymptotically stable, then you can guarantee Bebow stability. Okay. You can say the same thing about instability also. Yes. But there is a trouble when it comes to marginal stable systems. Okay. Even for linear case. Okay. Even for linear case. Okay, so why are we worried about Bebow stability? Of course, when set point is not equal to 0 and I have a closed loop control, this is my closed loop equation, I derived this some time back, and then I am worried about behavior between R and between Y. Okay, so in this case, I am worried about behavior between R and Y. Okay, so the question is the system Bebow stable? That means, is Y with reference to U, with respect to, Y with respect to R. R is now input to the closed loop. Okay. So is the system bounded input? So if I give bounded perturbations in the set point, okay, will the output remain bounded? Okay. When can you guarantee that? If you make sure that phi minus gamma GC is asymptotically stable, which means all the eigenvalues are strictly inside unit circle, okay, then you can say that this system will be bounded output stable, which means if I give bounded perturbations in the set point, output will be bounded. Okay. So that's why we worry about in the design. Okay, now stability tests. I'm going to do one simple stability test. In the context of today's context, for the this is most simple method, that is direct calculation of eigenvalues. You have phi matrix or you have denominator polynomial, you find out the eigenvalues. Okay, and simple tricks like Hurwitz criteria or Ruth Hurwitz criteria in today's context doesn't make too much sense because you have very powerful computers, and you would you know, download some program and say roots, and you will get, or your calculator itself, you know, might have some matrix eigenvalue calculations. So, nevertheless, there are some nice methods of analyzing roots of characteristic equation. You are aware of Hurwitz criteria, right? Hurwitz or what? Which stability test? Ruth Hurwitz stability criteria. So, of course, other method is root locus method. So I'm not going to get into root locus method. I'm going to take one method which is based on properties of the characteristic polynomial. Nyquist plots. You can do analysis using Nyquist plots. I'm not going to get into Nyquist plot analysis either. I'm going to talk about Lyapunov method very briefly because I need this in my subsequent development. This method of properties, now I need more for putting up a problem in my exam. And it's a nice tool by which you can find out whether the poles of a particular system, whether they are inside unit circle or outside unit circle, just by doing some simple hand calculations. You don't require a computer. So I'll talk about that particular method, which is very elegant method for finding out. And so this is called jury stability criteria. In the case of discrete time systems, we have this jury stability criteria. The Lyapunov stability is something which we will discuss later. Lyapunov stability is by a Russian scientist, Russian mathematician and physicist, Lyapunov, who lived in 19th century and made seminal contributions to theory of stability of differential equations. So let's look at jury stability criteria, postpone the Lyapunov stability business to the next class. It's fairly involved. So this is simple polynomial test. Given a polynomial, I want to find out whether the roots are inside the unit circle or outside the unit circle. Okay, and so this is my polynomial. Okay, I have this convention of numbering a naught even. So the coefficient of n is called a naught, and the last coefficient is called a n. Okay, you construct this table. Okay, now how do you construct this table? Well, I'll tell you a simple rule. You have written this a naught a 1 to a n here, and if you notice, the second row is a n minus 1 to a naught. Okay, now all that I want to do is to multiply this row by some factor and eliminate a n. Okay, I want to eliminate a n. So this thing here becomes 0 0. Okay, then see, I got this new row which has one element less. Okay, then what I have done is the same thing. See, here we first started with a naught and a n, then we wrote this row in the reverse order. Same thing. See, a naught, I got this row, then I wrote this row here in the reverse order. I want to eliminate this a n minus 1. Okay, I go on doing this till I get finally, you know, only one number finally. It's this is somewhat similar to what you have done in Ruth Hurwitz criteria. You go on eliminating. So once you do it for some simple system, you will understand how to do this. So very, maybe in the next class, in the beginning, we'll just do this. And then there is a test. You know, if a naught is greater than 0, and if all elements in this first, see, you have to look at elements here, a naught n minus 1, you will get a naught n minus 2, and so on. So if all of them are positive, okay, all the roots are inside the unit circle. Let me check. If all this a naught is positive, and if a naught 1 to k, that is all the first elements in the first column are positive, then all the roots are inside the unit circle. Okay, very simple test which you can do hand calculations and without even, or simple calculator calculations. You don't need some matrix eigenvalue calculation program. You can just find out whether the roots are, and you can find out, you can arrive at some necessary and sufficient condition for stability based on analysis of this. We'll look at this problem. Let me look at one simple problem. I have this problem, and if I use jury scheme, see, this is 1 a1 a2. I have written a2 a1 1. Okay, I multiply this entire row by a2 and subtract. If I subtract, this last thing here will be 0. Okay, then I get this 1 minus a2 square and a1 into 1 minus a2. I write this in the reverse order. See, this element has come here, this element has come here. Now you want to eliminate this term, okay, multiplied by appropriate factor and subtract, you will get only one term. So what is the jury stability criteria? See, this should be greater than 0, this should be greater than 0, this should be greater than 0. Okay, if all of them are greater than 0, then the system is stable. Well, which way it is stable? It will be Beebo stable. We are talking about roots of the characteristic polynomial. If all of them are positive, then we are, you know, asymptotic stability is guaranteed. So if you are doing trial and error, if you are using that G matrix, okay, if you guess some value and if you want to do hand calculations and see whether, you know, you are inside the unit circle or outside the unit circle, you could just apply this simple test on a piece of paper and then find out whether your controller designed is locally stable or locally unstable. Okay, so in this case, if you so this 1 minus a2 square should be greater than 0, and this second thing should be greater than 0. So this gives you these three conditions, and then you can actually plot in a1 a2 plane. You can plot, so any value of a1 a2 in this region, you will have a stable transfer function. That is what. So this business of Lyapunov stability, we'll look at it later. Okay, so this was a very deep concept which actually forms the entire foundation of stability analysis of differential equations, entire modern theory. theory of stability is founded on this. One thesis, PhD thesis, which was written by Lyapunov as his doctoral work. It's a seminal work which very, very few times it has happened that a doctoral thesis would entirely form a new branch of analysis. So we'll have a very brief look at this because we need this theory when we, as we go along. Okay.